I travelled half a world away to get to a place that some would call the canary in the coal mine when it comes to climate change. Greenland. I was here to observe a unique NASA mission called Operation Ice Bridge. Since 2009, NASA has been flying airborne missions out of Kangerlussuaq, a former US air base. The goal is to measure changes to the Arctic sea ice and the ice sheet over Greenland.
We're just on our way to the airbase, and I'm feeling kind of a bit nervous because I'm not the most relaxed of flyers, so let's see what happens.
It was 6 a.m. and about 10 degrees Fahrenheit.
So it's usually about a quarter mile walk to the plane, whatever condition it might be in. You get to the plane, you heat up your equipment, and I grab myself a hairdryer. And the hairdryer is used to heat up the equipment, and most of the equipment that we're using is off-the-shelf computer stuff, and it's designed to go in a climate-controlled room with humidity control, and none of that's here.
Here is a P-3, a plane originally designed by the US Navy as an anti-submarine aircraft.
That's the perfect airplane for this mission for many reasons. It was meant to travel long distances over big oceans at low altitude. Bounce around in the turbulence, just like we do up here in Greenland.
NASA has modified it with an array of scientific instruments and cameras.
This is the forward bomb bay in the
P-3. So this is where torpedoes would sit once upon a time.
That's true. And normally there'd be doors here that open and close. We've taken the doors away here and added a special fairing to carry three of the radars on board.
Jim Jungle is the program manager for a laser altimeter called the Airborne Topographic Mapper, also known as the ATM.
Working with lasers and airplanes are the two greatest things. I can't afford to buy a laser or an airplane on my own, so I get to work with NASA's.
The ATM measures surface elevations of the ice by sending out a carpet of laser pulses at the rate of 3,000 shots a second.
We measure the time of flight, the time it takes the pulse to leave the aircraft, strike the ground, and come back to the aircraft again.
We combine that with knowledge of exactly where the aircraft and the laser beam are pointed by a variety of instruments, and with knowledge of the aircraft's position in space. And when you put all that together, you wind up with an extremely detailed and extraordinarily accurate map of the topography beneath the flight path of the aircraft.
And by flying over many of the same flight paths each year, changes to the topography are documented.
Each laser shot has an accuracy of about 10 centimeters, about the size of a grapefruit.
And is that error significant in comparison to the way the ice sheet is changing?
But for the most part, the important regions of Greenland around the edges, the changes are on the order of 1 to 10 meters per year, so these are huge changes. We have scientists use our data to try to predict where the calving fronts on glaciers will be 5 years from now. How much more ice will we lose in the next 5 years?
In recent years, scientists have been concerned by the acceleration and increased thinning of many of Greenland's coastal glaciers, known as outlet glaciers.
I'm going to post the mission plan for today, the overall map, which shows where we're going.
Only minutes before takeoff, senior scientist John Sontag announces where exactly the plane is headed.
We've been doing this particular mission for 5 years now. This is the Southeast Glaciers mission. These glaciers have been particularly interesting in recent years. They started thinning quite dramatically in the early 2000s. And they all started thinning at the same time. And that really was a surprise. That's the reason we're here, is to continue to monitor that continued progression and why it's happening synchronously. Sort of infamous in iceberg circles. A lot of people who have flown in this mission have experienced pretty severe turbulence. We've learned over the years to avoid that, and that's what we're doing today.
In spite of his assurances, I was still a bit nervous. But I guess every job has its occupational hazards. Just minutes after takeoff, the science team begins taking measurements.
So we're flying very low, aren't we?
Yeah, we are typically flying about 1,500 feet. So the flight elevation is kind of tied to where the science instruments collect the best data.
For project scientist Michael Studinger, every bit of data counts.
You really have to map all the areas, even the areas that we think are not changing. Getting a complete map of the entire Greenland ice sheet is important. And we almost do it one glacier at a time. So that's really the benefit of an airborne mission.
NASA's Operation IceBridge is an airborne mission monitoring changes to the Arctic and Antarctic. They invited me on board one of their flights over Greenland.
Here on the NASA P3, there are no flight attendants. We have to make our own dinners. And after a few hours of flying, you certainly work up an appetite. Not bad.
There are a few creature comforts in this P3 plane, but it's simply business as usual for the scientists who spend 8 to 9 hours a day, 6 days a week in the air. Operation IceBridge began in 2009 after the satellite ICESat stopped functioning. With the next satellite, ICESat-2, not slated to be launched until 2016, the airborne missions were started to fill the gap, but they also take measurements that are impossible from space.
We fly 4 different radar systems on one aircraft, and that allows us to map the entire ice sheet from centimeter resolution at the surface down to the bottom of the ice sheet.
That doesn't happen on the satellite then?
If we could do this from satellite, it would be extremely helpful, but we can't fly these radars from 600 kilometers above the surface.
The most powerful of the radars on board is the MCORDS.
MCORDS basically stands for it's a multi-channel coherent radar depth sounding system, and it's basically designed to penetrate through multiple kilometers of ice and be able to image the bedrock of underneath an ice sheet.
We could say that, you know, the Mount Kilimanjaro is something around 5,000 meters tall, and we're able, that system, to depth sound ice sheets that are like 5,000 meters, basically. So it's pretty amazing.
So why is it important to know what Greenland looks like underneath the ice sheet?
The object for the glaciologists is to be able to go do glacial modeling based upon what is underneath and how quickly is the center of Greenland moving towards the outlet glaciers of Greenland and how quickly is that calving off.
So it looks like we are changing altitude.
Okay, we're gonna hit the glaciers. That's probably what it is.
Okay. The glaciers are coming. Back to our seats.
Collecting airborne data over glaciers requires precise flying.
It's important to place the aircraft exactly over the previous swath, otherwise we can't easily compare the measurements that we've taken with the previous year. So we had to invent a technique in order to place the aircraft exactly where it needs to be. We have some computers back here that compute our position using GPS. We display that path in the cockpit via tablet computers that are mounted on the pilot's yokes. You probably saw that. It basically looks like a video game. The pilot steers to keep the airplane icon over the path where we want it to be.
So I managed to get into the cockpit, which for a mechanical engineer is a dream come true. And we're heading towards the glaciers. And even though the views that I can see are absolutely beautiful, and that's enough in itself for me, this mission is all about collecting data and understanding exactly how the environment here in this harsh area of the world is changing.
Greenhouse gas emissions cause Earth's surface temperatures to rise. And here in the Arctic, they're rising twice as fast on average than any place else in the world. This is resulting in the melting of the ice sheet and glaciers.
Is there an environmental urgency to the shrinking?
NASA's stated purpose in its interest in ice sheets is basically protection of coastal communities. A very large portion of not only the United States' population, but the world's population lives very near coastal areas. So even a modest rise in sea level over, say, 100 years or 200 years could have dramatic impacts on humankind and on our own country.
In addition to gathering data for glaciologists, the team also spends a great deal of time on sea ice missions. Measurements collected from snow and accumulation radars can help form a complete picture of what lies beneath the ice.
We measure its thickness, and not only its thickness, but the thickness of the ice layer as distinct from the snow cover on top of that ice. If there's a snow layer on it, it is a much better insulator than the ice is alone because of all the air that's trapped, just like a good parka traps warm air next to your body. That's a very, very important process to understand if you want to model global climate, if you want to understand it.
According to recently released data, Arctic sea ice cover is now at a record low.
We have compared our data to the 30-40-year-old data and find huge differences there. And that is kind of consistent with what climate scientists say, that the whole climate of the Arctic has been changing.
But it's not just changes to the size of the ice that could affect climate change. This year, Operation Icebridge added a pair of spectrometers on board in order to monitor changes to the reflectivity of the ice. This measurement is known as albedo.
And if the albedo of the Arctic is changing, if more ice is melting and it's getting darker, it'll absorb more energy.
That's because the ice sheet almost acts like a mirror to sunlight, doesn't it?
It does, and in particular the sea ice. When the sea ice disappears and melts, you go from a very white surface to a very dark blue water surface. It absorbs a lot more energy from the sun.
Can you explain why that's such an issue?
We call it a positive feedback mechanism in science. If the Earth warms a bit, it could, that very warming causes it to warm yet more, and then it continues to build and build and build, like a snowball, rather, going downhill.
But for the Icebridge team, the first step is collecting the data needed to better understand climate change.
The goal here is to provide scientists with a unified package. Radar measurements, camera measurements, laser surface measurements that all agree and form a package of data that they can use to determine what's going on up here.
Flying on an airplane 1,500 feet above the ice sheet in Greenland and collecting scientific data, it's pretty unusual job. And I think part of this, you find people that are very motivated and very dedicated in doing this.
Great place to work. The view out the office window is fantastic.
That flight was absolutely incredible. I was a bit anxious at the beginning because it's a notoriously bumpy route with all the glaciers and kind of navigating in between them, but it was smooth, it was beautiful, and what was astounding was the way the crew and the scientists worked together to collect this essential data that we need to understand how the environment is changing around Greenland.
Coming up next, the life of a scientist on the road.
This ice is kind of special because it contains small gas particles that will bubble up when you add a little bit of liquid to it. In this case, we were lucky enough to find a little bit of whiskey, and you can hear the bubbles.
I came to Greenland to join NASA's Operation Icebridge. Their goal is to collect the critical data on how polar ice sheets are changing. Here in the Arctic, days are extremely long at this time of year. You have to stay up until nearly midnight to catch the famous northern lights. For the NASA scientists, home base is this facility, known as KISS.
Just taking off my boots. They are so heavy, so it's such a relief to get them off. And I'm keeping them outside my room because it seems to be the custom here. It's an indication that you're in. So, and I've also noticed that my room used to be a storage room. So welcome to my humble dwellings. I told you it was basic. So these are my flip-flops, essential when you're sharing a bathroom between men and women on a different floor. This is a second bed, which I'm supposed to be sharing this room with a roommate, and luckily I've got the place to myself. And the most important thing, my food supplies, which is mostly sugar and dried food where you just have to add water. It's a home away from home.
It's important at least to keep yourself fed at night because sometimes during the plane rides you can't always eat. You're either sitting down because of turbulence or your stomach doesn't want you to eat because of turbulence. So it's either one of the two. And so for me, dinner time is the time to stock up on the calories and get myself ready for the next day.
Okay, I think we had a pretty good flight today. I think the weather turned out to be exactly what we had hoped. Data collection was pretty good, so can't get any better than that. And as a bonus, we got to see some spectacular scenery. That said, so why don't we see what we have in plan for tomorrow?
This is not necessarily a 9-to-5 thing. If there's a problem, we'll investigate if it's a software problem or a hardware problem. If it's a hardware problem, I'll go in and fix them. We have these long days. Sometimes your mind wants to bail out of it and wants to move on to something else, maybe something more normal. But then I always think to myself, is that gonna be normal? Or is this actually normal?
The folks we travel with here kind of become a family. We make a lot of meals together. We look out for each other. And so that's a big part of what makes this whole thing, bearable and rewarding.
Should I make it a little drier still? What do you think?
It looks to me like you got it pretty close. It is a little bit pulley, so maybe a little bit more.
Yeah, what are you gonna put on yours?
You have pork sausage. I think mine is reindeer.
In fact, are you ready for a drink? That's good. All right. Well, what are we drinking? A little bit of glacier ice we picked. We rode out to the local land terminating glacier today.
And we're able to bring home about a 20-pound block. This ice is kind of special because it contains small gas particles that will bubble up when you add a little bit of liquid to it. In this case, we were lucky enough to find a little bit of whiskey and pour it in there, and you can hear the bubbles.
The glacier speaking to us, Kyle.
Cheers to that.
But the glaciers may be speaking to us in other ways too. I want to see for myself what it looks like up close. 80% of this country is covered in an ice sheet, and in some areas it reaches 2 miles deep. But this gigantic and ancient ice sheet is shrinking. Put simply, it's losing more ice each summer than it gains each winter. Since 2003, Greenland has been experiencing a net loss of 200 billion tons of ice a year. And as it melts, it has the potential to speed up further climate change.
Greenland, being one of the world's, primary ice masses, acts as a buffer on climate. They absorb energy that would otherwise go into the larger climate and warm things up more. As they start getting smaller, the potential impact to climate in Africa or in Papua New Guinea or in the United States begins to get potentially amplified.
Hence the term global warming.
It's global, yeah. And the early indicators are probably going to happen up here.
Only on Al Jazeera America.
A team of scientists are taking their inspiration from nature.
Technology is a vital part of who we are.
They had some dynamic fire behavior.
And what we do.
Transcranial direct stimulation. Don't try this at home.
TechKnow's team of experts show you how the miracles of science.
This is my selfie. What can you tell me about my future?
Can affect and surprise us.
Sharks like affection.
Catch new episodes of TechKnow on Al Jazeera America. Check your local listings or visit aljazeera.com.